April 10th at 4 p.m., the Chernobyl cleanup leader, Tatiana Manzarova, and the world-renowned anti-nuclear scientist, Dr. Natalia Mironova, will join us as we grieve. This benefit includes Joanna Macy, the groundbreaking writer who helped us understand the numbing effect of nuclear despair, and the U.S. premiere of Chernobyl Forever, a film featuring young people living near Chernobyl. Join us this Sunday, April 10th at 4 p.m. at the Fellowship of Unitarian Universalists at the corner of Cedar and Benita in Berkeley. This event is wheelchair accessible.
From the studios of KPFA in Berkeley, this is Education Today. Good afternoon and welcome to Education Today. I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. Today we're going to be talking with Catherine Murphy, who recently created a movie on the literacy work which has happened in Cuba over the last several decades. We want to welcome you to Education Today and ask you to tell us a little bit about what motivated you to make a movie on Cuba's literacy work.
Yeah, thanks for having me, first of all. I was in Cuba for much of the 90s. I actually went initially to do research on the community gardening movement. And when I was there, you know, met a broad spectrum of incredible human beings of many generations, and was particularly moved by a group of women that I met, spectacular women who had all done incredible things with their lives, and over time discovered that one of the things they had in common was having been teachers on the literacy campaign in 1961 as very young women, teenagers, some of them 12, 13, 14 years old. And I was really just fascinated by this and curious about what that moment was in terms of the transformation of an enormous group of individual women that was so powerful about personal transformation, collective transformation, nationhood transformation, and began to collect their stories.
So a lot of progressive people in the Bay Area have heard a little bit about the Cuban educational system. I would say there are hundreds and probably thousands of people who have gone to Cuba to see something about the system. And perhaps one of the things that has impressed many of us the most is this very rapid transformation in the literacy rate of Cuba in 1961. I wonder if you could say something about that. Kind of, we're interested in both the film and then also the content of what the Cubans have been doing educationally. So if you could talk to both of those, we'd be interested in that.
Yes. Well, you know, obviously one of the main structural barriers to a just society is inaccessible education, which was the case in Cuba before 1959. And one of the first things that the Cuban Revolution set out to do was to create a national education system parallel to a national healthcare system and many other important things, land reform, et cetera, urban reform. But education was so key, and they were very daring and visionary and bold in announcing in September of 1960 at the General Assembly of the United Nations that Cuba would become free of illiteracy in 1 year. And it was like unbelievable to the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. It seemed impossible.
It would seem impossible if they declared it again.
And they made it. So they made an open call for volunteer teachers. There were 6 million Cubans on the island at the time, 1 million of whom were illiterate, as per a 1953 UNESCO census. And so they set out to become fully literate with this open call for volunteer teachers. Well, 250,000 people stepped forward to volunteer as teachers, and 100,000 of those were youth, young people under 18, many of them, most of them 14 to 17 years old, high school students, junior high school students. And they, because education was called the Year of Education, and education was really set forward as the priority for the nation that year, that it was the everyone's priority. So young people that went to teach in the mountains and valleys, largely rural areas, but some urban areas as well, were liberated from school attendance that year. Also, I think with a very wise understanding that they would learn as much or more than they could teach. And so these incredible young people, along with adults and elders and a lot of teachers, because most of the teachers were mobilized as well to sort of function as coordinators and support people for the young volunteers, you know, set out in mass to the rural parts of the country and lived together with the families that they would teach and worked with them in the daytime and taught the classes on nights and weekends and really, you know, are a testament to what is possible in terms of education and much, much more. But by the end of that year, when they culminated that first big push of the literacy campaign, which the final march was on December 22nd, 1961, they declared Cuba free of illiteracy in that they had alphabetized or successfully taught 707,000 previously illiterate people to read and write.
And since then, Cuba has had a number of other campaigns to move people forward from that basic literacy, which they achieved in 1961, to higher and higher levels of literacy. And actually, I don't think there are many who dispute at this point that the Cubans, among all the countries of what's sometimes called the developing world, have a really remarkable system. And actually, I know a few U.S. people who've had their children go to school there, and we're quite impressed by what they learned. I want to give our phone number to our listeners. If you would like to talk with Catherine, ask some questions, or make a comment, our number is 510-848-4425. It's 510-848-4425, and we're talking with Catherine Murphy, who worked on a film on the Cuban Literacy Campaign and the follow-up to it. And so what I wanted to ask you about, besides this 50-year-old event of the Cuban successful campaign to make people literate, is what you find 50 years later, because I see from your website, which I also want to announce in a minute, the film of these women who were in the Cuban Literacy Campaign and now are talking about what impact it had on their lives. Can you say a bit about that?
Well, the Literacy Campaign really was a before and after moment for Cuban women. The young women, and women were over half of the volunteers, slightly over half of the volunteers. And for many of the young women, at that early age, to negotiate a degree of autonomy and independence that had never before been permitted for Cuban women because of the patriarchal family structure. And some of the women that we interviewed actually weren't allowed literally to leave their homes to go to the corner store by themselves. Wow. And entered into this discussion with their families, even very revolutionary families or families who very much supported the literacy campaign, did not were not so excited about having their young daughters go away from home for a year, live in the mountains, you know, no electricity, no way to easily communicate with them or reach them, especially all the tensions that were happening at the time. And these young women in mass were able to, again, I think really it's like negotiate a level of space of autonomy and freedom within their society that was unprecedented up until that moment, and which transformed their nation, was a key part of transforming their nation, transformed themselves deeply. And many of them say they never looked back. From that point on, they only looked forward. And what that's meant for women now, you know, 50 years later, is that women today in Cuba are 60% of the labor force. I think it's 65% of the labor force, 60% of many professions, and 44% of parliament, which is like double the representation of U.S. women in U.S. Congress, and have entered the, you know, the public sphere in mass and have a number of key positions of leadership in very important sectors, some leading scientists, Concepcion Campa, who was led the investigation that discovered the vaccine for meningitis, and women's lives have been consistently changing. That was absolutely a before and after moment.
Mm, beautiful. Now, you're visiting in the U.S. to show the film, and are you the filmmaker, or you're the filmmaker, and that was not your career before, or it was?
No, it wasn't. This beautiful story sort of pulled me into film. I had done some, I studied sociology. Mm-hmm. And have worked on a number of social issue documentaries, but this is my first film as a director, and the stories were so powerful when we first started to record women's stories about their experiences in the literacy campaign and what it meant for their lives and the development of their sense of self. You know, the first couple of years, you just did with paper and pencil, and then we did some audio, and it was just so immediately evident that it was a visual story. You know, the sparkle in their eyes, like the sense of just the powerful voice and the expression that with which they told it, kind of just demanded to be told in a visual, audiovisual form.
So you've been touring the country and our country, and I wonder what kind of response you get now to talking about Cuba, their successes. My perception is that not younger people are not so aware of what Cuba's done educationally, so I wonder what kind of reaction you're getting from people you talk to with the movie.
Yeah, we went on a multi-city U.S. tour. I say we because I was very honored to be joined by Dr. Norma Guillard, who is one of the women profiled in the film and is a leading social psychologist in Cuba today and really at the forefront of the continuing dialogue around race and gender justice, and also the sexual orientation, gender orientation issue, and the work to educate folks about, do education against homophobia, and they're lobbying now for civil unions. Dr. Guillard was with me on most of the tour, and she just left last night at midnight after our closing event, beautiful event at Mission Cultural Center last night. But we started in D.C., couple of screenings in D.C., and then we went to Jackson, Mississippi, where we were very honored to screen and participate in a conference of the Mississippi Civil Rights Veterans Association, and to talk with folks who had been, you know, on the front lines of the civil rights struggle here about that moment, similarities and differences, obviously, and also some of the experiences with the literacy work in the South at that time around voter registration and work against segregation and liberation education, talking a little bit about the freedom schools and stuff. And that's something that hopefully will flower in a number of ways. That was a really beautiful experience, very moving. And then we went on to Bozeman, Montana, and
quite a range there.
Yeah.
And what kind of reaction did you get in Bozeman, Montana?
We actually had a really incredibly positive response, more than we expected. I think one of the really, we met with Native American Studies Department, Women's Studies Department, Latin American Studies, and Film Studies, and there's a new film and activism program that's sort of being born now of Native American Studies and Film Studies coming together. And we had a really spectacular experience with them. We also met with some community groups, did a public screening that like about 600 people attended. And we also then screened to a high school, the main high school, with over 100 students. I mean, a full room, several different classes. And that was actually one of the more moving, I think, experiences for us, because young people in the States who really had not been exposed to Cuba, and much less the literacy campaign per se, or the Bay of Pigs invasion, or that moment, just were so, seemed so immediately connected to the story, because that's was they are today the age that these incredible women were when they participated in the literacy campaign. And the students, it was just really way more than we expected. The students were, you know, the movie, and they were like on the edge of their seats. They didn't want to leave. They were asking Norma all these stories. Well, how old were you, and why did you go, and what did your parents say, and weren't you scared? You know, the bell rang and they didn't want to leave, and we were surprised. Their teachers were even more surprised. And that was really beautiful. And I think also just really encouraged us to try to reach out to younger people more, because it's such a story of young people's empowerment and the positive role that young people can
have. I want to give our listeners again our telephone number, 510-848-4425. We're talking with Catherine Murphy, who has created a film on the Cuban literacy campaign. And I also want to be sure that people are able to see a bit of this themselves. So if you could tell the website where the material is.
It's www.theliteracyproject.org.
You want to say that again?
www.theliteracyproject.org. And we have an 8-minute trailer, or short, provisional short piece up on the homepage that folks can see.
And I watched it online and thought it was really very powerful. And I actually know a fair amount about the Cuban Literacy Campaign and have gone to see some things of it myself. So I was very excited by it. Can you tell us if you feel that the literacy campaign had any kind of effect on the international literacy scene? Did their methodology or anything else about what they were doing impact people internationally?
Absolutely. Many of the original teachers went on, of the original literacy volunteers went on to become teachers with their lives. And of those, there's a small group who dedicated their lives to adult literacy work. And a number of them, in particular, one teacher, who an amazing woman whose name is Leonella Relis, who was very young, she was 12 or 14 at the time, in 1961, at the time of the campaign. She was a key person in designing a methodology called Yo Si Puedo, or Yes, I can. Mm-hmm. And this is a Cuban design, mainly by Leonella Relis, amazing professor. Cuban methodology for teaching adult literacy in a condensed number of classes. And it's been applied in dozens of countries around the world, in numerous languages, in Bolivia, in Ecuador, in Venezuela. Almost 2 million people have gone through a teaching program called Misión Robinson. It's one of the social missions that has been happening in Venezuela in the last decade. The first step in their education program, Misión Robinson, was, you know, again for basic adult literacy, and is based on this Cuban teaching methodology. They're now also applying it in El Salvador and Nicaragua. They are applying it in Portuguese, in Brazil, in some of the MST communities, the landless movement communities in particular, also in the north of Argentina, in Spanish, in a number of indigenous languages around the Americas, Quechua, Guarani. They are using it in Haiti, in Haitian Creole, through the radio, in Mexico, in 5 states of Mexico, and also now in English, in Belize, in New Zealand, and some Maori communities, and now recently in Canada and some First Nations communities.
Wonderful. So. And I'm going to ask you a little more about that in a minute, about how people can get more information about that. We have a caller now, and I want to give you our number again, 510-848-4425. We have a caller from San Mateo, Ileana. Welcome to Education Today.
Hi, how are you?
Hi.
I'm originally from Cuba.
Yes.
And I was one of the people of the brigades.
Oh, beautiful.
And actually, it had a name. And the name was called Conrado Benitez.
Yes.
And Conrado Benitez symbolized in Cuba a martyr.
Yeah.
And he was chosen as a martyr because he was murdered. And he was a very, very prominent teacher. And what they did was actually was a little bit deeper than that. It wasn't about just teaching the people in the mountains and the ghettos and all of that how to read and write. It was teaching a whole new generation to integrate together and to see that we were all the same. The only difference was that somebody knew how to read and write and the other one didn't. And by teaching them that, then it kind of equalized the society itself to become integrated, because after a war, there's a lot of fragmentation.
Mm-hmm.
And by them doing this, they brought the people together. And like I've always said, one finger is not as strong as the whole hand. And Fidel was able to pull that off. He did it. It worked. And as I'm hearing on the radio that this kind of system has spread to Latin America, I've traveled all over Latin America, and the only thing that's holding back those countries is illiteracy. And with this new method of learning from Cuba, they'll be able to be free, in a sense that education is freedom. That's all I have to say.
Thank you so much. But we want to interview you. Don't hang up. Leave us your number.
We have. All right. If you're willing, would you want to tell how to get a hold of you? Or if you don't want to do it on the air, maybe we could have you call back the station.
All right.
No. I can give you my name, because actually I have spent 3/4 of my life working here with youth that are in danger with drugs and alcohol. And so by me having that kind of a background has really given me an edge to be able to work with young people.
So, Ileana, we might actually want to interview you more on our program in a later week, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
And so maybe you could call back and give the board operator your telephone number. He's willing to answer the phone and get your number from you.
Sure.
And thank you so much for calling in.
It's the same number?
It's very inspiring to talk with you. And our number again is 510-848-4425. And we're going to take another caller, Daniel from Oakland.
Hi. I think it's an excellent program, and I've recently seen a film called Maestra.
I think that might be the film, yes.
It's a great film, and I look forward to seeing it in its full version, because right now it's in its 33-minute version. But I don't want to talk about that. It's a brilliant film as it is. I just look forward to more of it being told.
Thank you.
What's possible in the film was this fabulous transformation of the teachers. The teachers were themselves teenagers. So they were making the revolution. They were making the revolution real. They understood ideals, and so they went off into the unknown, as it were. Young people, young women breaking social norms of the time, the restrictive social norms. The young women went off into independent lives as literacy instructors. They came back transformed. And so many of the 50,000 young people under 20 who participated in the literacy campaign in Cuba, these people have helped transform for the better Cuba as a society, as a place for humans to grow up sane. And I just think it's a brilliant film, and I think everybody in the United States should see it.
Thank you.
Thank you for calling, and people can see at least a little bit of it now, although it's done its last evening in the Bay Area for the time being, but you can see a little bit of it on the website. And I think the caller is making a really important point that probably the biggest thing that gets transformed in the educational process is the teacher rather than the people being taught. And I think a lot of us who've taught can testify to that.
Absolutely.
What are you doing next with this project? I forgot my question. I want to be sure we get to is, do you know of ways for people to be in touch with either the Spanish or the English version of the curriculum the Cubans have been spreading around?
We've been trying. There are a group of amazing community teachers around the United States who have been trying. I've been aware of it for about 5 years, trying to explore bringing the Cuban teaching methodology to the U.S. And one of the things that we're hoping to contribute to through this film, this process, is to connecting these folks and sort of maybe helping to revive that dialogue a little bit. Certainly people can provisionally contact us at the Literacy Project. It's info@theliteracyproject.org. I think it would be really spectacular to be able to start to use this amazing methodology in the United States, which has a huge and growing problem of illiteracy.
I know I've talked to people in Oakland who are interested in it, too. So we'll have to talk a little more, and I'll let you know whatever I find out. And we just have a few minutes left, but if you would want to tell us anything more about what direction you're going with the film or with this work.
I think now that we have a finished half-an-hour film, definitely looking long, you know, to try to do a longer piece, but more immediately to develop a curriculum and to accompany the film in schools at different levels, really wanting to reach out to high school students, raise some questions for them, and hopefully as well sort of an activist guide, and try to help make it relevant in the United States and participate in the dialogue here about what is happening to our education system, and to just keep alive the idea that education is a human right, and that we cannot let our public education system be stolen from us in the United States right under our noses without almost even noticing, that it is possible to educate everyone, that it is possible to alphabetize everyone. It's possible to have a fully literate nation. It's possible to have an educated nation, that the education process is a beautiful and empowering thing for everyone. It's a key piece of a democratic process, and that it's possible.
There are a couple of books, old books, written just after the Cuban Literacy Campaign that people who are very interested in this topic might want to look into. Jonathan Kozel wrote a book called Children of the Revolution, which first got me interested in the topic and familiar with the fact that it had even occurred. And then Karen Wald also wrote a book on Cuba, which I think Children of Che. Yeah. So maybe, you know, used from some used bookstore, people can find copies of it as well as looking. I wonder if you have a quick thought about how the Cubans would relate to our heavily tested system of holding children back and standardizing their curriculum and so on and so forth. Any thoughts?
Well, I think that, you know, one of the things that the content of the classes in the literacy campaign showed is how important it is that what's being taught is relevant to students.
Yeah.
And when you have testing-based education,
it's hard to be relevant. I want to really appreciate you for being on the program with us. I know people are very interested in this topic, and it's very important for us in the U.S. to be comparing our experiences internationally, not only with Cuba, but with other systems also, because there are a lot of things we're doing here that seem pretty abusive to kids, which I think a lot of countries actually don't do so badly. So it's really wonderful to hear from you and exciting work that you're doing. And would like to thank our listeners for listening and calling in. Our programs air on the second and fourth Fridays of the month. The producer for Education Today are Kevin Cartwright and Jaron Epstein. And I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. Thank you for tuning in, and we'll be talking with you again soon. Bye-bye.
This is KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, and 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online all around the world at kpfa.org. It's 3:00.